Well, welcome back, and we're going to talk about climbing a ladder this morning. So some of you are in careers and you say that you start on the bottom rung. So we're going to talk about sort of kind of climbing a ladder, but it's a ladder about our approaching God. How do we get nearer and nearer to God? And which step of the ladder are we on the most of the time and right now? And we're going to talk about approaching God. We're going to look at some Bible words and their practical application. So you might think it's pretty obvious what the first one's going to be, and that's going to be approach to God in prayer. And there are some words that we use frequently in regard to approaching God in prayer. Words like ask, pray, make request. And then there are a couple of others that you find in the New Testament of the Bible. Supplicate and intercede. And long words like that aren't in our everyday vocabulary. You don't walk up to your friend and say, I've been supplicating God for you. You might say, I've been praying for you. And if you really love your friend, and if the problem that they're suffering from is really serious, and if you're down on your knees and really asking God to do something very special, then that's probably what you're doing. You're supplicating God. So supplicating is an intense form of prayer. Interceding. And somebody has to stand in the middle. We call them an arbitrator, don't we? Somebody who's going to stand in the middle and try and work out a solution. So what they have to do is they have to listen to one side, and then they go and explain that side's position to the other side. And they intercede for them with their opponent. Now, that's the way that we use it in everyday situations, interceding. But some kinds of prayer are prayers of intercession. When we intercede, you may have a friend who doesn't know God yet, and they're not praying for themselves, but you want to pray to God for them. You stand in between them and God. It's not that they come to you and say, oh, you're a priest, will you pray for me? It's you as a friend, without even them knowing it perhaps. You intercede because you take their problem, and you, on behalf of them, you go to God. So you go between, you intercede for them. So those are long words, but we're not going to focus on supplication and intercession. We're going to focus on the simple words, pray, ask, make request, things like that. Now, you know that when the Bible was written, it wasn't written in English anyway. And so all these English words that we're using are translations of Bible words. Sometimes the Bible has more words than we do in our English language. We use one word in our English language to translate several words in the Greek language, which is the language of the New Testament. So, and here are some Greek words that you find in the New Testament of the Bible, and you won't be expected to know how to pronounce them, nor am I. I wasn't around 2,000 years ago when they were being penned. But the first one is aetio, and the second one is eroteo. Aetio and eroteo. I may have the pronunciation wrong, but there's nobody that was around then that can say, you're doing it wrong. It's all assumptions that we make now from modern Greek usage as to how they should be pronounced. But those are those two Greek words, and they both, whenever they're used in the New Testament of the Bible, they're both translated pray. But they mean something slightly different. And I'm going to illustrate that by looking at some Bible verses. The first one is in John 14, and verse 14 and verse 16. And if you don't remember what that is, you can be looking it up, but this is what it says. It's on the screen. If you ask me, Jesus says, if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. And that's the first word. You see the yellow ATO and the yellow ask? That's one word. Then he says in verse 16, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper. That's responding to a big need that we have, a helper, the Holy Spirit, with us. And Jesus says that on behalf of the disciples, he will ask the Father. That's the other word, the red word, eroteo, ask. See how it says ask in both places in the English? But it's translating different words. Why? The first one, aetio, is the normal word for asking. And normally when you're asking for something, you are asking for it because somebody else has got it and they have the power to give it to you. And in a sense, you're subordinate to them. You need it, they've got it, so you ask for it. So whenever you're asking a superior for something, then you use the word in the Greek language, aetio. But you know, when Jesus asks his Father, he's not asking as a subordinate. He's asking the one who he's equal to. God the Son was present with God the Father all eternity, and when he became a man, he's still God. So when he's asking the Father, he uses a different Greek word. And this is the Greek word that is used when you're asking an equal. So if any of you are asking anything of me, then you'd probably use eroteo, because you know that I'm not above you. But if you're going to ask God for something, then you've got to be careful to say the ato word, if you like. And that's why Jesus tells the disciples, you ask me anything in my name. You ask as a subordinate to somebody who's got superior power to you. But when I ask the Father, I will ask him as an equal, and he will give you the help that you need. Do you see the difference? What this should remind us of is when we pray, when we're on the bottom rung of the ladder of approaching God, is that we really are on the bottom rung. And God is so much higher than us. It's not like Jack and the Beanstalk, and it's going to take us 20 minutes to get up there, and there's a big giant at the end. It's more like what was seen in the book of Genesis, where there's a ladder erected from earth to heaven, and there's angels ascending and descending on it. God's up there. That's where he lives. Can you imagine a ladder that reaches to heaven? That's what Jacob could imagine in his dream, in his vision. And we're right at the bottom rung. Angels can go up and down. Can you imagine how much greater God is than us? And how appropriate it is that when we ask, we remember that we're not asking as an equal. So the words that you use when you pray to God, when you approach God in prayer, should reflect the fact that you understand that he is very, very great. And we are very, very insignificant. But he allows us to ask. Now, you say, all right, yeah, got it. On to the next. Well, not quite. Because there's another verse where John, who wrote in John 14, the words that we've already read together, he also wrote in 1 John 5 and verse 16. And again, he uses these two different words in close proximity. Now, you know, when you're writing, you can change the words that you use just to make it a little bit more nice to read, you know, use synonyms and everything. But sometimes when you've got a different point to make, you change the word. I think that's what John did here. Let's read what he says in John 1 John 5 verse 16. It's a really difficult passage. He says, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask. Oh, that's the yellow word again. Look. And God will for him give life to those who commit sin not leading to death. There's a sin leading to death. I do not say that he should make request for this. This word, make request, is exactly the same as the red word that Jesus used when he said, I'm going to speak to my Father about this and he'll give it to you because I'm his equal. And John says, well, if you're dealing with a sin that doesn't lead to death, you can ask God as a subordinate and God will give you an answer to your prayer. You pray in the will of God and he wants to answer it. But when you're dealing with a sin leading to death, not concerning that do I say that you should make request. Should I? Not concerning that do I say that you can dictate terms to God. Sometimes people do things that are so serious and they're facing the judgment that God himself and his sovereign will is going to impose on them, that you can't say, God, you've got it wrong. I'm not appealing to you as a subordinate now. I'm telling you as your equal. I'm making a request of you. Just get this right, God. Look, you know, I know this guy did this thing, or this lady did this thing, but you know what? In the grand scheme of things, it's not all that big, is it? So, you know, why don't we just let him off this time? Not concerning that do I suggest that you should assume that you can make a request as though you were God's equal. In other words, God's got his sovereign will. Does that mean that they're going to die? It might. The one that I use in this is that it's easier to use it in a physical illustration, where Ananias and Sapphira come before Peter and they say that they've given something, but they tell lies. And he says, you've not just lied to me, you've lied to God. You've lied to the Holy Spirit, you've lied to God. And what happens to them? Out they go. The lights turn out and they're gone. The wife comes in, Sapphira, a few minutes later. He asks her the same question. She gives the same lie. He says, the ones that carried you out, carried your father, your husband out, are going to carry you out too. Gone. Lights out. Out they go. they had committed a sin that led to their physical death. Peter didn't say, I'm going to argue with God about this because we really needed the money. And if I talk to you nicely, I mean, you might cough up the other half that you didn't give. No, no. He just, because he has an understanding of the will of God in the matter, and he can see that this is a sin that leads to death, their physical death in this case, they die. He doesn't get in the way by asking an inappropriate request of God. Now, when was the last time you said to God, well, this person needs to die? No, no. God, Peter was an apostle and he had an inside track to the will of God in this matter. You may not have that. I may not have that. So it's hard for us to define a sin that leads to death. But you might know that a person has a particular weakness. You see them observing that and going after that particular weakness that in their life is going to disrupt their life so bad, that it's going to wreck everything that they do. And it's going to wreck other people's lives as well. Do you have to go to God and say, well, just let them carry on, let them carry on. Look, I'm asking you, I'm imploring you. This is what the word means, areteo. And because I'm asking you, and you know, why don't you just let them off? And God is saying, for this kind of sin, they're better off dead. Not our role to disagree with God. So the difficulty in this verse is understanding what's the difference between a sin that leads to death and a sin that doesn't lead to death. Because all sins are pretty bad stuff. And we can talk about that later. All I wanted to point out was that John's change of word in the second part, when he's dealing with a sin that leads to death, gives us a little bit of insight that when we're dealing with serious issues, what he's indicating by his change of word is when we're dealing with the most serious issues and we go to God about it, we're not there to appeal as an equal. We should still be there as a subordinate. Appealing, even stronger. I would say, if you're faced with someone you love who's making a big mistake in their life, you pray harder. He's not saying don't pray for them. He's saying don't pray as though you were God's equal. Can you see the point? Okay, what's the second thing that's up? Approaching God. Oh, approaching God to give thanks. Now, again, there are two ways that this can be expressed. And in the New Testament of the Bible, sometimes it's giving thanks and sometimes it's agreeing, giving an assent. Can you think about thanksgiving for a minute? Do you speak to God in thanksgiving? Yeah, we did that this morning, didn't we? In our remembrance of the Lord Jesus. What did we thank him for? Thank you, God, for forgiving my sins. When did you first realize that God had forgiven your sins? Long time ago, when I was a kid. Or, you know, last year. Or when we still feel asking God to accept your thanksgiving for forgiving your sins. Has he given you anything else? Has he given you the things that you asked for? Well, if I didn't ask, I wouldn't know whether he gave them to me or not, would I? Well, maybe I have got things that I'm thankful for, in addition to the forgiveness of sins. But if I didn't ask, I won't recognize, thankfully, that God has answered. Thanksgiving is preceded by requesting. If we don't request, then we won't know that God is responding to our request. And you might get the good stuff anyway. And you might be thankful that you got it, even though you didn't ask for it. How many kids have just gone through the Christmas experience? Isn't it fantastic? They put together their Christmas list, and they want the new Tesla car. Well, that's what I wanted. And they don't get it. Well, they're disappointed on that. But there's lots of things on the Christmas list that their parents say, oh, well, it's on his Christmas list. I'll give it to him. But then there's a bundle of other things that the kids never expected, and they still got. Do you think they're thankful? Oh, yeah. Even though they didn't ask for them, they get them, they're thankful. Same for us. God says, be thankful. We'll look at some verses. But again, there are two words. And the first word that is the word Eucharistio. Yeah, that's hard to pronounce, isn't it? But have you ever bumped into people that go to their church and they say they're going to the Eucharist? Yeah, because what we did this morning on a Sunday morning, when we remember the Lord Jesus, it's called the breaking of the bread in the Bible. It's also called remembrance. But it's a thanksgiving event, isn't it? We're thanking God for the loaf. We're thanking God for the wine. It's a thanks. We've been given something. And because we see that it's not just the bread and it's not just the wine, but it's what they represent, we're very thankful. And so we call that occasion sometimes the Eucharist. And the verb is Eucharistio. So that's one that means to give thanks. And another one means homologio, and that means to assent or agree. We'll come to that one in a minute. Let's look at the first one first. Ephesians 5 and 20. Paul says, giving thanks, when? Always. For what? Everything. To God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see the way that proper prayer is done? It's to God the Father in the name of God the Son, your Lord and mine, Jesus Christ. You will go to some churches and you hear them say, well, Lord, thank you very much. Oh, Jesus, you're wonderful. Oh, Holy Spirit, I'm speaking to you now and asking you to bless us. That's not a Bible prayer. A Bible prayer is giving thanks to God the Father in the name of the Son. That's the right way to pray. But it says giving thanks always and for everything. So that might be a little bit difficult when you're going through tough times, when you're feeling really down, then you don't know why you're feeling down, but you still got to give thanks to God. And sometimes the act of giving thanks will release you from the down feelings and help you to be lifted up. God knows what he's doing when he tells you to give thanks. So I'm going to leave that one there. But please remember, if you're short of things to give thanks to God for, it probably means you've been short on the asking side. Because if you're asking for more, you'd know whether he'd answered or not, and you'd be able to be thankful for the things that you knew you asked for and you got. If you keep asking for the same thing again and again and again and again, and forget to ask for other things, and he doesn't give you that one thing that is so big to you, then you're not going to be so thankful, because you're not going to realize all of the other things that you could have asked for that he could have given. So please remember, even in the minor things that come into your life, pray to God about them and then say thank you when you get them. As an example of homologio, homo means the same, logio is a word. So it's a word that means the same. That means agreement, doesn't it? If we say the same word as somebody else, we're agreeing with them. Hebrews 13, verse 15. Through him then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that give thanks to his name. And there's that word, give thanks. And it's one word in Greek, the word homologio, giving thanks. What we're saying here, God has done something. We should respond to what God has done. How do we respond? We agree with him about it. And when you assent to what God has done, then that's a type of thanksgiving. So sometimes this is difficult things in your life. Sometimes it's the great things in your life. And you realize it's the work of God and the word of God that's being fulfilled in what's going on. And you agree with it. So good old Greeks, they've got a separate word for that. We're just going to say, I'm going to give thanks. They say, yeah, I'm going to give thanks by assenting to what God has done. Okay, our words show we agree with God about his authority. That's what it means about his name, right? When we ask in Jesus' name, we're not just going to say Jesus like Fred or John or Lydia. It's not the name, it's what name means. And to a Greek-speaking person, they knew that name meant authority. One of the people in the audience here today works in the township. Top of the ladder in the township is the mayor, I think. If you're at the front desk and you've got to sign something on behalf of the mayor, if you just sort of say, well, I'm just going to sign this with my ordinary name and everything and that'll be okay, that's one thing. But if the mayor tells you to do it and says, sign this off in my name, then you say, on behalf of the mayor, and you sign it. It's the mayor's authority that goes with it, not yours. Nobody would care who you are. You can sign it Father Christmas if you like. It doesn't make any difference. It's the fact that it's in the name of the mayor that makes the difference. In England, the police force largely is unarmed. And sometimes they're in a situation where they stop a criminal. And the criminal's running towards them or away from them. And what does the policeman do? He says, stop. Stop, because I'm Fred. No. They just carry on running. They don't stop for Fred. They might in America, if Fred's got a gun out of his holster, but in the UK, there's no gun. Stop in the name of Fred. No, stop in the name of the law. They better stop. All the weight of the law, you must agree and obey with what the policeman says. You're doing it in the policeman's name, not the policeman's name as Fred, but in the name of the law that he presents to you, and you must stop. We ask in the name of the Lord Jesus in our prayer, because when God is listening to what we're asking for, he's trying to see if it agrees with what he thinks should be done. When he does, he's going to give it. And he's not going to give it because you say, "Hi, I'm Jeff, I deserve this." You're going to say, "I'm Jeff, and I'm here to ask on behalf of Jesus Christ, your son, my Lord, because I think this is what Jesus wants." And that long sentence is just another way of expressing in the name of. So when we pray and when we give thanks, we're still doing it the same way, going the same route to the Father through the Son, because it's the Son's name that makes our prayer, our requests, our approach effective. What's the next one up the ladder? We've dealt with prayer. We've dealt with thanksgiving. I wonder what the next one up is. Something even more important or better than even thanksgiving. Yippee! Praise! Well, thank you very much for watching this talk on approaching God in different ways. And we hope that you'll come back next week to hear the conclusion of the talk on this subject. And now, please stay with us and we'll enjoy some singing time together.